of Gotham, a crazy podcast about DC, with your host E-Rock and PD. When we speak up, get your geeks up, cause you know you about to get geeked up. So sit back, relax, and get comfy. Lose your mind like Solomon Grundy, and listen to a show that won't be forgotten, coming straight out of Gotham.
And hello, everyone out in Halsey Land. Welcome to episode 122 of Straight Outta Gotham. We are a fandom pop culture podcast and a proud member of the Batman Podcast Network. Hosted by Batman on Film. Make sure you check out all of the great shows on our network by heading on over to batmanonfilm.com and clicking the podcast drop down and checking out all the other great shows that everyone has to offer. Lots of great stuff over there. I am your co-host from the other side of the Hudson River, senior contributor BUF. I'm Peter R. Verite, recording on July 10th, 2023. And as always, we have a great show for you today. But I'd like to remind you that we do the monthly contest. So if you rate and review our show on iTunes or Apple Podcasts and we review on air, you win our contest, so make sure you get those reviews in. Now, let me introduce you to my partner in crime, the man who won the most consecutive pickleball games in the history of Oakdale Veterans Middle School, a BUF junior contributor, ladies and gentlemen, the champion of Long Island himself.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Yeah. Yes, yet another feat. Pickleball is really on the rise.
Real man of greatness. Like that old Bud Light commercial back when people
pickleball is only becoming popular now, but it's been a thing for a long time. People don't understand that. So it's all right, though.
And you've been running the show.
I let people, it's whatever. I'm sick and tired of people piggybacking off my stuff and trying to be popular, make it whatever. But
trendsetter.
Yeah, I don't need this crap. Literally. So that's the thing. And, it's kind of fun. It's not like cornhole, which to me is like bowling for drunks. But
it's a tailgate game.
Yeah, but it's actually become like a thing, and there's like there's leagues.
Really, I did not know that.
Professional. I didn't either until it might have been 2 4th of July's ago. Was it 4th of July? It might have been. I was watching. I had ESPN on because I was waiting to watch the hot dog competition, and they had like the National Cornhole Tournament thing. I'm like, wait, really? This is real? Yes. They actually have a professional league for cornhole. So, yeah, it's a real thing.
All right. I had no idea.
I know. I
was not expecting that.
The axe throwing thing is cool. That I think I would
I've done
like
that. That's fun. I've done that.
Yeah, that I think would be fun. But, right. Yeah. So what's going on? How are you?
Now that I had a lazy Sunday, I feel like I didn't do anything all day today, to be brutally honest. Or yesterday, I guess. Past 12 a.m. here. So
I was running all over the place.
Yeah, you were just Holzimon on the go?
I was. And then family visited. It was a long day.
I thought we were texting earlier. I thought you went out to dinner. So I was like, oh, man. Like,
I did. We did. Oh, wow. We went out to dinner.
And they just
came
won't leave.
Visit. They came to visit, and like I wasn't cooking, so I'm like, well, then we have to go somewhere because I'm not cooking.
Eric's famous, strombolaya.
What?
it's like this thing you made up. It's somewhere between stromboli and jambalaya. Strombolaya. Holzman's famous strombolaya.
I don't even know how that would work.
It's only available on Long Island. So it's champion exclusive. I think they only serve it at the Hempstead Diner.
I'm just trying to think how that would work. Okay. That'd be a very carb heavy meal. I'd say that.
What is it in this area?
That's true. Most Italian food is very
carbon. You're in like the land of like Pizza Huts, just pizzerias galore.
Yes. That's what I told you. My town and the next one over, there's pizza places and Italian restaurants. Like,
it's like at least every town has at least three.
All over
there. At least three pizzerias.
Yeah. It's nuts. Luckily, we have a German restaurant, though, for me. So that's good. But
there you go. You get your schnitzel.
Yeah, I could get schnitzel and wurst and all that fun stuff.
Holzendoss. What? That's the ice cream. Cold
that sounds like that's something. Haagen-Dazs is Dutch, Pete, not German.
Yeah, that's why you're Holzendoss. You're the German version of Haagen-Dazs.
Oh, okay.
You know?
Sure.
It's like when you just win like Eric, it's hard to keep track. You know?
Yeah, that's it.
He's like Tom Brady in that aspect. Only Eric and Brady knows what that feels like. So
yeah, well, that's true.
Why they're goats, such great friends.
We're goats. When goats get together, you get more goats.
Geeks. Goats what? And geeks.
What?
You get goats, you get geeks. Geeks and the streets.
What's the plural of mouse, Pete?
Mice.
Okay, good.
Mace.
That's what I thought. That's what I was gonna, that's what I thought you might say.
Mice? Mouses? So what's the plural? Moose. Moose.
I did say mouses once. To annoy this person.
It's like when you talk about computer mice, are they mice or are they mouses?
They're mice.
Yeah, just curious. I wonder. It's things I've pondered as I'm like on the John.
That's where most people do your best thing, their right? best thinking on the John. That's true. Yeah, so all right. Well, we're gonna kind of get through some reviews because
it's review season.
Yes, and because you finally caught up to a lot of things, so we can just run through them. So what do you want to start with?
Let's start with a cartoon.
All right. So yeah, so on Max there's the new Superman cartoon called My Adventures with Superman.
I think it actually debuts on Cartoon Network the day before, whenever it is. I think it's on Wednesdays or Tuesdays.
Okay. And yes, they released two episodes. Well, I don't know if about the Cartoon Network, but there were two episodes on Max. That's how I watched it. Mm-hmm. And I think it's interesting. I'll say that. It's the anime style kind of animation, which is not I'm not the biggest fan of to begin with. But, you know, I enjoyed I guess hope is the best way to put it. And I know that's corny because that's what this stands for. But the symbol stands for. But yeah, it was kind of like it does portray that. The show is very much in line with who the character actually is. And it's kind of refreshing. I mean, obviously we get it in Superman and Lois, but I thought that this was a very good attempt at it. You got the Lois with the short hair. You have Jimmy Olsen, who's African American in this. So there's different flavors for everybody in this show. And I thought it was a really good attempt, a really good start. I don't know if we weren't doing this show, I don't know if I would have watched it, to be honest with you, because even though I think it's well put together, I don't think it's for someone like me. Mm-hmm. But I did think it was endearing and cute and truthful to the material. What about you? What'd you think?
I really liked it. I was into it. I like how they're all interns. You know, I thought Jimmy was really cool. Like, I miss Jimmy Olsen more than anything.
Right.
To be honest, like, if it's been a while since even Superman and Lois, like, you know, we got Jimmy Olsen Supergirl. It wasn't really, you know, he was jacked. He wasn't.
Yeah.
Like, it was like, where's my ginger with the bow tie? You know, like,
yep.
It was like, this is not the new Jimmy Olsen I think of. So it's been a while since we kind of got like a proper, just kind of trigger happy photojournalist Jimmy Olsen. And I thought that was really cool. And I like how Ma and Pa Kent were. And I like how young he is. And he's still a little naive. And, you know, I was digging it. I'm interested. You know, at the end of this, but Cat Grant and Lombard get involved. I'm like, that's great. Yep. For politics within the Daily Planet, and like that's the stuff like in Man of Steel that I was like teased that I never got with any of the other movies. You know, so I'm really excited to see this kind of unfold and really kind of any form of media, live action or. But, you know, so like even Superman Lois doesn't really have that either. Like, there's no real, they work at the Smallville newspaper, right? Like, they're not working in Metropolis at the planet. So, this is cool. Like, this is like kind of what I envision Superman really is, you know? Like, So I kind of like it, and I'm digging it. And the anime style didn't bother me at all, so I'm looking forward to when they get to more traditional Superman villains. Right now, they kind of seem to just getting their feet wet and giving you an idea of what he can do. And, you know, kind of it's like a tour around the city with kind of like what I figure is low-level villains in the first two episodes. And, you know, they'll build from there. But, you know, I think there's a lot of promise here.
Yeah, they kind of make him, like you said, naive, but also a little bit of the clumsy Clark that we got to see in the 78 film, a little bit of that. They kind of hinted that with him. You know, Lois is very much, I thought that she was the one that they kind of nailed pretty well.
Yeah.
You know, she was the character on the show that they kind of nailed pretty well. Again, it's a younger version of her, and she's an intern, and how they massage that and how they fit that into the story is very cool. Oh, wow, that's my voice cracking. And and then Jimmy is pretty much Jimmy, like the Jimmy that we've gotten to know most of his.
It's just nice to have that character back, really.
Yeah, so it was cool. And it's cool that they're focusing on the three of them. Yeah. I think that was cool, too, how that a lot of times I felt like Jimmy is kind of, you know, off to the side. But this one, he's very much part of what they're doing. And I thought that was cool. Interesting take with the villains. You know, they mentioned also Task Force X, which you see at the end.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, there's interesting takes there, and that was Slade. I didn't know that at first.
I had to double check. I wasn't sure.
Yeah, but it was Slade, so I was like, okay. So that was interesting too. So yeah, they're kind of pulling things from other all places, but
it kind of felt very Fleischer, like he's just fighting these giant robots.
Yeah, yeah, and it's very, but it was put together well. I'll say that. I just don't know. It's made for kids, so that's what I'm saying, and clearly it is. So I don't know if I'll be able to stick with it, but I will continue to give it a try and watch it.
As long as they keep putting it up on Max, I'll be able to stick with it more than I would be able to having to watch it on TV, because I feel just with my schedule, like I could. They're not long; they're like 20-minute episodes, so like I could binge like three or four of them at a time.
All right, so let's stick with Superman, because we also had Superman and Lois, and I believe we touched on this last week, but you hadn't seen it yet. So we said that you had seen the season finale. So what did you think? I'll let you go first. What did you think about the?
I thought it was really good. Everything. I'm really impressed with what they did. Everything they did with Bruno Mannheim, I thought was really brilliant. excuse me. I like that more than like having to like force Lex Luthor in. Like, I like how they used Lex at literally like the last two or three episodes, right? And it's just, I was like, oh my god. And then what's his name nailed it, Abraham. I had a tweet earlier. I was like, yo, Walking Dead just totally dominated the season of Superman and Lois.
His name is Michael Cudlitz. That's the actor.
Yeah,
name.
But even what's his name, Mr. Coleman, who played Tyrese and Mr. Mannheim.
Yeah,
like the two of them, like they just the Walking Dead guys just walked in and just kicked ass.
Yeah,
it was really great to watch. I knew Mateo was somehow going to be tied to Bruno Mannheim, but I had no idea that Pia was going to be the wife.
Okay,
you know, like so, like there were a lot of twists and turns. Like they didn't. I was able to get. Like, I felt very proud of myself, but a lot of the other ones throughout the season, I didn't. I'm a little kind of annoyed that now another person knows that Clark is Superman. Like, I don't know if Cushing needs to know, but we'll see what's going on. That was fine. But he's getting cut from next season anyway.
Yeah.
So they ended the season, you know, obviously versus Doomsday, which I thought was great. But a lot of these characters got cut. I believe Steel was also cut. A lot of Smallville people, I believe they're going back to Metropolis. I don't know what they're really going to do, to be honest with you, because I believe Steel was cut, Lana was cut, General Lane was cut. I believe all these people, you know, so season four is going to look a little different. But
right. Well, they're cut as regulars. They're not cut from the show. They're cut as being on every show.
Yeah, well, I mean, I don't know. Right. Like, I get so, Lana being cut, but I think Sam Lane's a big part of the season, right? Like, at least a part of starting season four, he's got – thought the way they kidnapped him was pretty brilliant.
Yeah. Yeah, that too. And then you had, of course, John Henry and Lana hooking up.
Which we saw in Superwoman Rebirth, so it's not the first time it's happened.
And you see Chrissy is pregnant with Kyle's baby, which is kind of the soap opera-y portion of the show, I like to call it.
Yeah, between him and Lana.
Yep. And the kids were, I mean, I don't know. I think Sarah, strangely enough, I think she's one of the better characters on the show. The character of Sarah.
I really like new Jonathan.
So, yeah, he's good. Mm-hmm. But
Jordan, I never agree with. I always think he does the wrong thing. I always agree with his parents. I was like, am I an old man now?
He's just so bad. Like, that actor is so bad. I kind of wish he was the one that left, not the other guy, because he's so terrible. Every time he's on the screen, I'm like, I don't believe he could be a superhero. I don't believe he has terrible timing.
Yeah.
Dude, he's the worst part of the show.
He's the weakest part of the show, easily.
Yeah.
Which is a little bit of a bummer because he kind of rose to prominence because now he's got powers. You know,
yeah. So
he's more of a plot device than anything else.
Yes. They should have given Jonathan the powers.
Jonathan was too busy covering up for his crackhead girlfriend.
I know.
Or his crack dealing girlfriend.
That's a crazy thing. Yeah. I don't know.
But the season went really deep with Lois and her cancer treatments and everything and all that. Like, that took an unexpected turn. Nobody saw that.
Yes. That
and it only got better actually from when that was pretty much announced.
Yeah, I mean, she's so good. She is literally the best actor on the show.
Yeah.
She's fantastic. And
well, they're both really good. Hulkling sells to Superman really well.
He does.
You know,
he does.
I think this is the best Superman since Superman 2.
It's fair. You can definitely make.
Yeah. And that includes all the other TV shows that have come before it.
You can make that. Definitely make that argument. I can't argue.
I really do. I think it is. I don't know how many people are actually watching it. You know, but, like, I know it's popular for CW and I know it's popular amongst the fans, but I don't know how many people are actually watching this iteration of Superman, which I think it's really good. I think a lot of people could actually dig it.
I do too. I think if people actually sat down and watched it and gave it a shot and took the CW part out of their mind when they were watching it, because I think that a lot of people who immediately just dismiss it because it's on that channel, I think if they gave it a shot, they'd probably enjoy it because it is it's a very true, when you think of Superman, the way he's portrayed on this show, it's very, very true to that character. So
I do think they've got to spend more time out of Smallville, though, because I feel like it's blatantly obvious. Superman, like, who in town doesn't know at this point to begin with? And I don't know. I just feel like it's not very well hidden who Superman is. But I guess that's why they're in Smallville, because it's, you know, small enough to keep the secret. But
exactly.
There is part of it. That's kind of what I didn't like about Smallville, the show, was like everything just kind of happens in Smallville, but everything originates in Smallville. Whereas this is like everything's like everything happened in Metropolis, but now it's all happening in Smallville.
Well,
even Lex is walking to Smallville.
Well, the show Smallville was called Smallville, so it's very hard not to do things in Smallville.
No, I get it. I just like everyone comes from Smallville, and then they go to Metropolis. It's just like way too convenient for me.
Yeah, and I mean, and the kids.
That goes for the old comic books too.
Well, the reason that they moved to Smallville was for the kids, so they're getting older now, right?
They had a little bit of an angle, but I'm just saying, like, now after three seasons, like, right, Smallville constantly being ground zero for everything and anything, right? Like,
well, like you said, next season they cut a lot of the Smallville cast.
Yeah, I'm very interested in what they do. Because I really dug what they did with John Henry Irons and Steel. I thought that was really fun. Same thing with Natalie. You know, they came from the other realm. And playing the multiverse angle there, which is all the rage these days. So,
you know. Well, we will see them. There were other characters. I just don't know how much, but we will see them next season.
Oh, there were two Diggle references, by the way, in like
these.
So it's not as disconnected as they once said. They once said that this was a completely new iteration, completely disconnected. Now, even just referencing Diggle, it's like, okay, is this still this Superman from the crossovers?
Yes, I do. I guess that'll be revealed, maybe. I don't know.
I'd like to get Kara to show up just once. It'd be nice. That's the one thing that's missing. Like, you know, where's their cousin? I'm just saying. I feel like she should have popped up at some point.
Maybe they will, because if next season is the final season, which it seems like they're hinting that it could be, then yeah, it'd be a good time to bring her in. I don't see that being an issue. So yeah, so as we're talking about, guys, Superman and Lois, it does. Pete brought up Doomsday. There's been a lot of talk about the Doomsday angle on this, and it was actually very clever how they did it, and it's a pretty good interpretation, I thought.
It's interesting. I don't know. Like, I kind of prefer the old school of Doomsday, of just kind of like the killing machine that just kind of landed here.
Right.
It seems to be a trend now that something turns into Doomsday.
Yes.
So, you know, you just kind of roll with it. It's not the worst in the world. It's probably not my favorite. I don't like how, you know, he's got like the suit embedded into his like Doomsday skin. That's a little weird.
Right.
But it was interesting how they created him and what they used. It was the Bizarro Superman, the Inverse right. Superman. And Lex doing it, you know, it was very Superman-esque, right?
Yes. Like,
very science fiction-y. It was cool. The guy who was helping Lex, his name is Otis. So yep. It was cool. It was fun. I don't know if the chick who tricked General Lane, whose name is Miss Tessmacher. I don't know if that was it.
Yeah, they didn't name her.
Maybe they did on the app, and I just didn't notice it. So I have to, because they did show her face really quickly on the Danny app, because he's Danny again. Mm-hmm. So that's Jordan's fault, by the way. So it's another reason I like Jordan. But yeah, like, so that was interesting. You know, it's interesting now that Doomsday flies. This is the second iteration of Doomsday that flies, BVS being the first. So, yeah, I don't know. To be honest, I think the one that looks the best, geez, it was probably, I posted this on Twitter. I wonder what's winning of the four live, I believe there's only four live action Doomsdays. It's BVS, it's Krypton, Smallville, and now Superman and Lois. And I wonder who's winning. But I don't know. I think Krypton did it best. I have to rewatch that series. I don't think I've ever finished it.
They've done a lot. They did. I mean, they had Brainiac too. They did Brainiac yeah. too. And I thought that was solid on that show.
I got to rewatch that.
Yeah, it was good. And yeah, I mean, they obviously, that's how they end this season and this.
The fight was great. I thought the fight was for CW's budget was really cool. Like, the action parts were really great. You know, like, I dug it. I thought it was fun, man. I really enjoyed it. I think this show is so much fun.
It is. It was a needed version. They needed to do something with Superman, and this came along at the right time.
I don't think they knew what they were doing. You
know? Right.
Like, I don't think coming out of the CW crossovers, they really knew what they had.
No, I mean, but they needed, there was such disappointment with what was going on in the movies on the big screen, that this was kind of a way for them to have Superman out there. Mm-hmm. And
I'm glad they took advantage of it, though.
Yeah. I agree. It's been great.
I feel bad for anyone who's not watching the show, because I think it's a great iteration of Superman.
Yeah, like I said before, if you could take it out of your mind that this show is on the CW, because like I said, that's a baked in thing for people, you'd probably enjoy it even more. So this has been, this show has been pretty, pretty solid and consistent for the 3 years it's been on. There's been obviously highlights and lowlights, but.
Because to be honest, it reminds me a lot of like Superman, not Superman, Lois and Clark, because that show took a lot of liberties at the time, and I think this show does too, but I think it works better for this show. But I also think with the liberties they do it, they're a little bit more faithful, like Doomsday being a prime example. You know, I don't know. Like, I just feel like I think they do it with a lot of care here.
They do. And like I said, they had to get something right in live action with Superman. And I think this has been a good filler for that role right now.
Where's my Tyler Hoechlin Superman action figure? Like, can I get one? Can someone make one?
They don't have one?
No.
I could have swore Zachy had one.
He got like one of those like hot toys. Like, I think it was like counterfeit hot toys, because like no one makes them. So he had like somebody out there just did. Like, it's like a custom.
Okay. Kit, is it? All right.
But yeah, no, he does. It looks really good. That's a little bit. I was looking more like the lines of like, you know, my action figures, like from Tom McFarlane. You know, the plastic ones. Those are a little bit more high end. I don't really like the hot toy type things. That's more a hobby thing. Hobby loves that stuff. I'm not like, I have one. It's good. That's enough for me. I like plastic. I like my toys with plastic.
Yeah.
God damn it, Eric, you should know this. Dude, we've been doing a show for how long?
You post so many toys and you buy so many toys.
No, I'm not.
Yeah, you do.
No, I
do. You do.
Too many.
You do. You should really, you have to have a kid so you could give all these toys to your kid.
No, what I need is to actually put them in like cabinets, curio cabinets. Or
all right. So, guys, if you've been watching Superman and Lois and you want to get at us about
so much fun.
Let us know what you think after the episode's up. Just respond to in the Facebook group. Let us know what you think, because I enjoy talking about CW shows in the group. It's kind of it's a lot of fun.
It's great. We can talk some Flash. Eric, we should get Eric to rewatch Supergirl. We should get Eric to do like a retro Arrow review. I think he would love that.
I did one with JJ on his show.
A little jelly belly right there.
I did one with that. So yeah. Definitely definitely let us know if you're watching again Superman and Lois. Let us know what you think of the show in the Facebook group. All right, so Pete, you finally got to see Transformers Rise of the Beasts. Before I get into that, I don't know if you guys saw, I got my Optimus Prime popcorn head.
Looks phenomenal.
Right?
Do you have it with you? Can I see it light up?
Oh, I don't have it in the room I'm in.
All right, we'll have to get it
right now. But yeah, I can show you later. I mean, it's very similar to the Batman one that everyone got, the Batman one when the Batman
came out. Yours lights up.
Yeah, it does light up. There's a little light switch on the bottom to light up, and it's much bigger. The capacity in this one is much bigger than the capacity.
Did you actually eat popcorn out of it?
No, I didn't even get it at the movies. I bought it through their website. You bought it
online? That's amazing. Yeah. You don't have to go to the movies to buy these things.
I went to the Cinemark website and I looked and they had it. So I'm like, all right, I'll just pick it up.
There you go. That's about it.
Right. Yeah, so I got that. That was it's pretty awesome. But the movie itself, Pete, I will let you go since you just saw it today or yesterday.
Saturday.
Yeah. Yes, you saw it on Saturday. Yeah. So yeah, go ahead, talk about the movie.
I thought it was great. I had so much fun with it. I thought what's his name? Pete Davidson.
Anthony Ramos? Oh, Pete Davidson.
Anthony Ramos was great. Pete Davidson was great as Mirage. Some of the best Transformers fights you're seeing. It was like straight up the cartoon brought to life. Like between Bumblebee and this movie, you're going to get some really great Transformer fighting, and lots of great like just classic laser shooting and stuff like that. Like everything you love about the old cartoon, that's what that is. I had so much fun with this movie. This is definitely like a top tier Transformers movie in my opinion. End credits tying into G.I. Joe is interesting.
Uh-huh. Right.
I don't know. That's obviously a comic book series. That's a crossover that actually happened.
Yes.
So there's source material to it. So maybe some research is in order. It'd be nice to get outside of Gotham, unlike Ryan Lauer. So, you know, I guess I got some reading to do. But I may give this the edge over Bumblebee, me personally, because there's a lot more Prime in this. And because Mirage reminds me of Jazz just as a car. Mm-hmm. You know, I miss Jazz so much. The best thing about it is I'm interested in Transformers again because I'm like, is this a reboot? Can I get Jazz back? Like, what's kind of happening here? This seems kind of like a timeline refresher. The last night doesn't matter. Like, am I going back to Transformers? What was the fourth one? What the hell was the name?
Age of Extinction.
Yeah, Age of Extinction. I was like, that seems to be the last Transformers movie that actually matters. Before last night, and so I'm trying to piece it all together, and I'm really interested in it. I think Optimus looks so good in this movie. I wish they would cover his mouth more. I don't know why they have to have like Optimus have lips. That's like an obsession. Optimus Primal, it was great to see him there. Perlman did a great job with the voice. I'm gonna pre-order the expensive action figures. I thought it looked great. His beast mode was great. Cheetor looked really good. You know, it was a little of a bummer not having like Rat Trap there, but like, you know, I understand. Rhinox was cool. You know, I just really enjoyed everything. Bumblebee coming back was amazing. Like that was an epic moment. I love the old aircraft carrier plane thing. That thing was awesome. He was funny. I just had a blast with it. It was great. It was a solid Transformers movie. Like it's, I don't know. Like I put a tweet out earlier yesterday. I was like, I don't know what's wrong with the general audience because I've had nothing but fun at the movies this summer. Like everything I've seen, I've really enjoyed. I really have. I've really enjoyed Spider-Verse. I enjoyed Flash, Indiana Jones, Transformers. Like, you know, I know I missed some things, but like I've had a blast. I've only, you know, I'm going once a weekend. So I don't know. Like, I'm really having fun at the movies and I feel bad that no one's going to see these things, but I thought Transformers was great. I really did. I loved it. I absolutely loved it.
What did you think of Dominique Fishback? I forget her name in the show.
The archaeologist?
Yes.
She was funny. She was cracking me up, man. You know?
Did you?
I like Scourge. I thought Scourge was a good villain. I'm glad it wasn't Megatron again. I'm really digging that stuff, you know?
Yeah, they did.
Unicron's interesting because he's so big.
Yeah, they did have like Scourge as the having him as the henchman type for Unicron, which is not a leap that did happen. So yeah, so that was a cool thing. Yeah, I mean, I don't understand it either. I mean, unless you're just not fans of the franchise or this movie is not something that people care to see anymore. Maybe the Bay movies got them tired. I don't know, but yeah, I thought this movie deserved better. I feel like I've been saying that so much this summer, but I did. I felt like the movie deserved a lot better. And I saw it twice. Yeah, I mean, I saw it twice. And both times, the second time I remember coming out of it saying, wow, I liked it better this time. Needle drops are great. Yeah. I mean, everything in the movie is just really well done. There's some wonky CGI parts. I'm not going to lie. Like when he puts on the suit, when he becomes Mirage kind of, and he takes the piece of it. That's probably
my least favorite part of the movie, you know?
But yeah, but I mean, that was a little wonky and stuff. But no, I mean, it's a very, very good traditional summer blockbuster. And if you're fans of the franchise, I mean, I don't know anyone who's a fan of Transformers and saw this and said they hated it. They might have had issues with it, but most people I know who are big fans of the franchise liked it.
Yeah, so, I really did. I really did.
So, yeah, so I'm hoping, I don't know what the future is right now, but I'm hoping that we get one. If they're going to do the crossover with G.I. Joe, I mean, they might need to just to save that franchise because those movies were rough and Snake Eyes was no better.
Yeah, those movies are not good. And I didn't see Snake Eyes.
So, yeah, so I don't know how they're going to do it or what they're going to do going forward, but I think there's enough here that they will continue with the Transformers franchise. Where they go next, I don't know.
I think the back-to-back really good movies between Bumblebee and this.
Yeah, that's what I think. But again, it's not. Maybe it's true. Maybe people just don't want to watch these movies anymore. Because last night I went to see Call of Freedom. I think it was what it was called. And dude, I went at 9:45, I believe, and the theater was almost packed. And that is not a franchise. That's just it's a movie about child trafficking. It's very it's a heavy film. But yeah, I mean, a lot of people were there. So maybe people just want more traditional movies now. I don't know. I can't explain it. Summertime usually is the time where you get to see you want to see blockbusters because you want to sit in the movies for a long time and eat the popcorn and just have fun. But maybe not. I don't know.
That's what I've been doing, so I don't get it.
I don't either. It's a crazy phenomenon we're having this summer. And there was
COVID didn't kill the movie theaters. The movie theaters killed the movie theaters.
Maybe, man. Maybe just the movies. Yeah, the movies killed the movie theater, like what they're putting out there. But yeah.
It's weird when no one likes what you like. Like it's just like you're like, oh man, do I have bad taste?
Well, speaking of, you finally watched Ant-Man Quantumania and you actually liked it. So you're one of the
liked it a lot, man. Yeah. I was like, this was fun. I thought it was like I really dug the whole like going down deep and Janet having, you know, experienced, you know, Kang and everything. The Bill Murray stuff was interesting and I really like the whole Scott and Cassie angles, and I thought Cassie fighting was really cool, and I was into it. You know, the only thing I didn't really like it was towards the end. My problem, the least favorite part of the movie was that towards the end when it was like, is Kang gone? Is Kang gone? I don't know. Is Kang gone? You know, he's walking down the street trying to figure out, and then at Cassie's birthday, is Kang gone? Did I defeat Kang? Did I beat Kang? There's more Kang. I don't know. And then, you know, obviously you see the post-credit scene, so.
What did you think of MODOK?
Here's the thing. MODOK is like my Marvel usually doesn't involve MODOK.
Okay.
Like, in the books that I read. My Spider-Man, my Fantastic Four, MODOK does not pop up in the Fantastic Four books. I really just, unless there's something I missed, like in George Perez's Fantastic Four, there's not a whole lot of MODOK in there.
Right, right.
So to be honest, and when it comes to Ant-Man, I think because I don't really read Ant-Man, like I'm Holzman here. I don't, you know, I'm not reading this stuff. Right. So I just go in, I just watch the movie, not knowing anything, and I enjoy it because I don't know what to be upset about.
Right.
You know, like I know in the comics, Hank Pym is like kind of like, you know, he beats his wife. He's like a, you know, big domestic violence type thing. I think he kills her actually at some point. Something like that. It's not good. But I know that's like history and comic, but it's not like that at all in the MCU. So I don't know. Like I'm looking at it like one essential Marvels. I don't read a lot of it. So, but I had fun with the movies. I think Paul Rudd's hilarious. I'm a big Paul Rudd fan, so that helps with me. But yeah, like actually these three Ant-Man movies, I really enjoy it. I enjoy the third one more than the second one. But I really like Ant-Man, the first one. And I'm just a fan of the trilogy. It's weird. I really like it.
So you like that they made him Darren and tied it into the first film with that?
Yeah, it didn't bother me at all.
Okay.
It didn't bother me because like, I don't know like who this is supposed to be. I did some like Googling afterwards. And I don't know. Like, I was like, this character is so weird already. Like, why are people?
It is. It is strange. It's a strange character. I'm not going to lie. It is. But I didn't like that. And the actress who played Cassie, I just didn't like that character either. And that's
I love Cassie. I love seeing her back. I love seeing her girl kind of grow up over the years.
No, I don't think that the material was bad. I just don't think the actress did a good job delivering it.
I think she needs a cool name. I don't know. Does she have a name in the comics? Someone let us know. Because I've been trying to think of something. Is she like, oh man, could she be like, I don't know, the Purple Beetle, the purple? I'm like, because she's got purple in her suit. Like, what could she be? I'm trying to think of things like, would you, I don't know if you're a member of the Ant-Man family, like, does anyone want to be the cockroach? Like, does anyone want to be that? I'm the flea, you know, like you can't be the tick that's already taken. Like who could it be? Like, I'm trying to think of bugs.
I think Stinger is the name.
Okay.
That she's most known for.
So she does have a name. That's cool. But yeah. I dig it.
I believe that. But
I like the movie. It's like mid MCU for me. It's right in the middle of the bunch. It's fun. Okay. It's average. Like I could pop it in and enjoy it. Like I mean, it's funny how like not knowing anything can lead to you really enjoying something. Like, oh, this is all I know.
It's true. Oh. It's true. I agree. Like the less you know about the source material, the more you're going to enjoy. Like there's so like Harry Potter, for example, if you read the books, there's so many other things in the books that aren't in the movies. And I know that bothers some people, but I never read the book. So I just enjoy them because I enjoy the films. So it's just a similar thing. But Majors obviously saves the film and makes it watchable for me. He is so good as Kang.
Yeah, he was good. I actually thought Paul Rudd did a really great job.
See, he was just kind of there. Like, I felt like him and Hope were both just kind of there. Like, they weren't part of the story until obviously the fight at the end.
I thought it was a good fight too, by the way.
It was a good fight. And to me, that was the best we got to see him fighting, where he wasn't kind of joking around.
Yeah.
It was kind of a serious battle for him. And I thought that was interesting. Like, that was one of the things I did like in the movie. But yeah, just, I don't know. Overall, it didn't work for me. It's not the worst movie I've ever seen. I mean, will I rewatch it again? Probably not, unless like they're doing another team up and I have to, you know, I want to do that. Oh, let's watch all the movies again. That you do from time to time. Maybe, but I did not love it. But I'm glad you did. If you're going to go to the movies and are you going to watch a movie, I'm glad that
you watched it. I'm glad I did not like it. Does that make sense? I enjoyed it.
I 100% agree. I'm glad that you enjoyed it. And
I'm just surprised so many people hate it. I'm like, wow, this movie is like, I remember.
Yeah, I hate
it. I just couldn't see it because it was just time and I was busy. But I remember everyone just like openly just shitting on this movie.
Hate is a little strong. Like, I don't understand.
Everyone was making fun of the CGI and the background and all this, which is what everyone does for every movie. But like, I just felt for this one it was a lot more noticeable.
I mean, the way that the speed that they turn these films out in now, if the people who are like, oh, they should use practical effects, I don't think it's possible. So that's kind of my response to people that I don't think there's a person alive who does not enjoy practical effects over computer generated imaging. I do not think there's, I don't know anybody who alive who says, oh, I'd rather have the computer imaging. Nobody does. but you got to be practical.
And I think Reno likes CGI more than anybody I know.
Yeah, okay. He's gonna come at you for that one. That's for sure.
Yes, Reno. Yes, runs Canada. Yes, I like the video game look of movie. It's nice. I like when I go see a movie, like, oh, yes, PlayStation. Yes, Reno. Yes, go Xbox. Yes, Reno. Yes.
All right. So, Pete, there's one movie out there that's coming out that you have been worried about getting toned down. But now we have yet another person saying that's not going to happen. Deadpool 3 is coming. And the actor who plays Dopinder in the movie, Karan Soni, who plays Dopinder in the films, says that this should be as hard R as ever.
That's so great.
Wow. Yes. So that's what he's saying.
And he's not even really in most of the movie, probably.
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, he's got a good role in the first two, so.
Is he in the second one? I don't remember.
Yeah. He's the taxi driver.
I don't remember. After we watched the second one. It's been a while since I watched the Deadpool movies, to be honest.
The second one is, I like it.
It's good. They're both very good.
Yeah. So this is what he said. They've begun working on it, so he can say that. That is the same as the other two. It's like a hard R. There's a lot of that stuff, so it does not feel different. The only thing that for me is different is that I have not gotten the script. Here's another person saying how Marvel is so tight, tight with the scripts and strict. He has not seen, he said he's only seen glimpses of what he's in. And then he said, when I did some of the stuff, I saw some things that I didn't know were in the thing. I think I would just say it's this way. Ryan Reynolds doesn't need to do any of these movies unless he gets to do his version of it. And he's such a star, and I don't need to say this, a creative genius. He's taking this opportunity and really pushing everything, and definitely he's doing a lot of cool stuff. I feel very optimistic about it. Him and Sean Levy work so well together. It'd be really exciting for people to see how they take their collaborations that they've done now successfully twice in this new version and play in this massive sandbox with a lot of stuff. It's very exciting. And he will not underestimate Ryan Reynolds. So,
can we just give Ryan Reynolds like the keys to Green Lantern and say, can you just do whatever you want to do, like you did for Deadpool?
Dude. Do you
feel that passionately about this character? Like, because it seems like, you know, he loves this stuff, you know?
Yeah, I mean, he fought hard to get this movie made. I mean, he even made that. Remember that video footage of the fight in the first one in the taxi cab that he did.
He leaked it. Yeah.
Remember he leaked that. So I mean, he fought hard to get this one made, and this is definitely his baby. I think in a lot of ways.
But it also comes with a lot of like questions.
What do you mean?
Well, I mean, this is clearly a multiversal movie.
Well, yes.
And then the big news coming out of the week, coming into the weekend, was that Gardner's coming back to play Elektra.
Yes. She's coming back.
But I'm saying, like, if no one came back for Keaton's Batman, who's going to come back for a movie they hated 20 years ago? You know, it's just funny. It's like, does Gardner's Elektra and possibly Affleck's Daredevil, does that, like, or are just people so jacked up for Jackman? Right, like, does Jackman have the effect to draw the audience in because he's way more recent than Keaton?
I think that number one.
Or does this bomb like everything else?
I think number two, when it comes to Hugh Jackman, too, is he has a broader fan base. He's done Broadway. Mm-hmm. I think a lot more people across different spectrums of media know him, so that might draw people. I don't think having Jennifer Garner as Elektra in Deadpool 3 is going to be a big draw.
Like, I don't know if I guess that's why it was part of like the Friday news dump.
Yeah,
you know, just like, but still, it's like it's weird. Like, okay, like this movie seems to be the last like entry in the multiverse. Right, like I feel like everybody has gone so heavy multiverse stuff. They've got it. Somebody's got to take a break at some point.
Right, and I have a feeling it's gonna be like he does the fourth wall stuff. I think I have a feeling a lot of the multiverse stuff is gonna be in that dialogue when he's talking about. He's gonna point things out that are obvious and make fun of it because that's part of the character. So I think he's gonna do that. But I think it's cool she's coming back. I liked her in Daredevil. That the movie she did on her own, the Elektra movie, that was horrible.
I don't remember it. I know I watched it because I remember being like, at the time, I was like, oh, this is cool. Zod is training Elektra. Because Terrence Stamp plays Stick in the movie. So that was like back in the day. That's all we had, you know, before you guys got spoiled. I know. Having, you know, like six comic book movies a year. Back in the day, all we had was we looked forward to Elektra.
But I wonder if they're going to do the crazy thing and have not Ben Affleck, but Charlie Cox.
Interesting. Yeah, I don't know.
Right?
That's, I mean, or like you said, if you do multiverse stuff, like, you know, we've seen different actors play Spider-Man and then in the MCU. So I can't imagine why this movie, because this is his first MCU movie. And like, I can't, if they could, they've done it now with, oh my God. I mean, Spider-Man, Doctor Strange, Avengers, even like you've had these other actors come in for these roles. So like, I wouldn't be surprised.
I wouldn't either. Not at all. I would not be surprised. So, but it is cool for her in a way that she gets to come back and play this role.
When's this one come out? Do we know?
Hold on.
Because I'm interested to see, like, does this movie flop? Is Deadpool still relevant? Is Deadpool in the MCU a big deal? Like, there's a lot of like kind of like questions you have. Like, CBM movies outside of Spider-Man haven't been doing so good.
It seems next like. May 3rd next May. Year.
All right. So we got some time. So who knows what the landscape will be like?
Yeah, I mean,
it could totally change. Everything could change.
When the Marvels come out, so that's the next MCU film, right?
You're having the watch party, right? At the state theater in Long Island.
I'm not having a watch party, but I am wondering how Secret Invasion is going to attach to it somehow.
You're the only person I see ever talking about it on Twitter, so I'm wondering. I'm looking forward Secret to diving Invasion? Into it. Yeah, that's why I feel like I'm not seeing a lot of traction on it.
I don't understand it. It's obviously, to me, it is the best TV MCU project for me since Hawkeye. I really, really enjoy it. It's a typical spy story. It's not, you know, it doesn't have a superhero in it. They are referenced and they talk about them, but they're not in it. It's very much Nick Fury and Talos' story, more on Fury. You find out a lot of things about his life in the, even in the short amount of time. And Kingsley Benadire is so good as Gravik.
I recently read the book and I actually didn't like it.
I know. I remember you saying that. It's not. It is not the book.
And apparently it's nothing like the book. Yes, so like, it's not the book. Like, this is like the thing that Marvel does. Like, we're going to take this thing, instead of properly naming it, we're going to name it something else. Like, okay.
I mean, there are references and it aligns with it a little bit. But overall, it's not. It's not the book. So, but definitely, I think if you're not watching it, I don't understand why.
Only reason is because I had to get there.
People in general. I'm talking to our audience. If you're not watching it, though, you're really missing out. It's really well done. It's a slower burn. Yes, I'm not going to sit here and tell you it's a fast movie film. It definitely is It definitely is a slower burn. But I mean, the acting's solid. Fury. I mean, Jackson and Cheadle have a really good scene. And Mendelsohn and Jackson have good chemistry. It's just a really, really good. Olivia Colman is fantastic. She's fantastic in everything, but she's in this too, and it's really, really well done. So when you get it, Pete, when you get around to
it, I'm probably going to start it tomorrow before I go to work. I think that's what I'll probably end up doing.
So, but I enjoyed it. I'm enjoying it.
Worst case scenario, I'll start it this weekend. But it's definitely like, you know, everything's pretty much done. Actually, to be honest with you, I think I have like two episodes of Titans I still have to watch, but that's like pulling teeth for me.
Well, the last episode is a tough for me. Was a tough watch
for Titans.
Yeah, not because I was upset, but because I was getting to the point like, all right, yeah, we need to end this show. I'm glad it's ending.
It's so disappointing.
Yeah, it wasn't. All right, so we have talked. There's been a lot of talks about releasing cuts of other films, and one of them has been the Schumacher cut of Batman Forever. Mm-hmm. We have people have been asking for it. Pete, you've said you'd like to see the Schumacher cut.
Yeah,
I know. I mean, obviously,
Kevin Smith screened it like I think a weekend ago.
Yep, he reviewed it. He screened it. We know little bits about it. Obviously, if you ever saw the Red Diary stuff. that was pulled out. You know, there's footage of that. So we've seen little bits and pieces of it. But Akiva Goldsman, who was the screenwriter on that, which is crazy when you think about it, he did an interview.
He was big in the 90s, man.
He was. On the Playlist Bingeworth podcast. And this is how he talked about the Schumacher Cut. He said, I saw the Schumacher Cut recently, and it's funny because there's been a swell on the internet for it, and I stay out of it mostly. Although it's got about 35% more psychological realism in it. You know, it's really more about guilt and shame, but the preview audience didn't want it. The world wasn't ready. Joel's first cut had all of it in, and the audience was like, yeah, we just like the part where the guy's funny and he's scary and the big thing. And so I just got cut down to what it is, and it was cool. So I thought it was weird that he said the world wasn't ready for it when the movie before it, Batman Returns, was kind of, you know, heavy.
Yeah,
and,
you know, I feel like maybe this was written a little bit better, though, to be honest with you.
Yeah, that's true.
I think Goldsman's probably a better writer.
Right.
So hopefully we'll see it. I know they screened it. A lot of people liked it. Apparently, there's some things. I know the Dick Grayson laundry, the infamous Dick Grayson laundry scene, apparently is not in the Schumacher cut. So there's different stuff there. It's shuffled around. So, I mean, if I ever get a chance to see it, I'd like to. But, you know, we'll see.
Yes. And he went on to say that he'd like to see it for Joel Schumacher because there wasn't a lot of things honoring him. And it would be a cool way to honor him to release it. And he said he'd probably get a kick out of it if he was alive. So. Yeah, I mean, it is something I definitely think I would watch and want to see. You know, that movie, I like it. I've liked it from the beginning.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
I know it gets a lot of heat and flack from people.
Retroactive heat.
Yes, because when it came out, it was a huge hit.
Yeah, it was.
But, I mean, I have issues with it. I think we all do. But, you know, it's a fun film. It really is. I like it. So
it's a good summer blockbuster.
Yeah.
Apparently those don't count anymore.
Well, no. If it came out, dude, if that movie came out today, it would get destroyed.
Unfortunately.
Like, destroyed. And I mean, that's, hey, as much as we like the Nolan, the Dark Knight trilogy, it's his fault. It is his fault that people expect these certain level of films now, and to the MCU to some degree. But yes, it's mostly Nolan's fault.
Are you ready for Oppenheimer? Are you ready for Oppenheimer?
You know what? I am.
Because you love to hate Nolan.
No, I don't.
You do. You don't give Nolan the credit he deserves.
What are you talking about?
You're anti-Nolan.
No, you're getting.
You don't like Tenet. You don't like this. You don't like Dunkirk.
I don't like Dunkirk.
You've been anti-Nolan for a while, and it's fine. It's own up to it, man. Since when do you not own up to being anti-Nolan?
Because I'm not.
Nah, you're anti-Nolan.
No, I just think at this point in his career, he's constantly. No, he's constantly trying to prove he's the smartest guy in the room in every film he does now. Nope. And
I gotta watch Tenet.
It's not a fun or it's not entertaining. To watch that and to be sitting there because it feels like literally someone's talking down to you. And that's how I felt with Tenet. Dunkirk, I didn't feel that way because that was a period piece, which is why I'm excited for Oppenheimer because it's a period piece. It's based on an actual event that happened.
That's right. Nolan being Nolan, baby.
So, yeah. And it's going to allow it probably saved him from himself in a lot of respects doing this movie. So I'm looking forward to it. But it's funny you bring this up. I was just talking about Nolan films recently. Outside of the Batman movies, Pete, and I guess have you seen Interstellar? You've seen
Prestige? I've not seen Interstellar. Prestige I love, yes.
So Prestige.
I'm not a Nolanite.
Have you seen any of the earlier films like Insomnia, Memento, any of those?
Yeah, not in a while, but I have, yeah.
Okay. All right. So I guess we'll just stick with the Dark Knight trilogy. I'll ask you, because I think I've asked you before, but I don't remember your answer. Which of the three is your favorite?
Rises.
Rises is your favorite. Okay.
Yeah. Best one's probably Begins.
Well, no, the best movie is The Dark Knight. That is the best movie.
I think it's Begins. I think Dark Knight's sexier. Dark Knight's sexy. It's a hot blonde. You know, Begins is that, you know, olive skin girl, brown hair with a big old fat ace.
Begins is my favorite of the three, but The Dark Knight is the best movie of the three.
I can argue Dark Knight's good. Begins is great. You know, I get Wato will sell you too. Wato will sell with Begins. A lot of people sell with Begins. It's just as good in my opinion.
Okay.
I think Begins is underrated.
My favorite. It's my favorite of the three. I love that movie. Whenever I go to watch them, that's the first one obviously it's the first film, but if I'm just sitting around like, I want to throw in a Batman movie, that's usually the one I'll throw on. That or 89. Definitely. That or 89. Those are the two that I'll...
89 has probably, honestly, the most rewatchability of any Batman movie. And that's just because you get sucked into Nicholson.
Yeah. Like
Nicholson is... they say, and this is Max Schreck's line in Returns, but it's true for Nicholson. His charisma is bigger than both of us. You know, it's just... you just get... totally sucked into that Joker performance. It's the greatest. It is the best Joker performance of all time, Jack Nicholson.
Oh, wow.
It is. It's better than Heath. It is. It just is. You know? Sorry.
Is that because it's more of the Joker you like?
It's just more because of that's the Joker.
Right. Okay. That's what I meant. Like, if
Heath's Joker is very close. It's very, very close. It's there. But Nicholson's Joker, that's the Joker. That really is the Joker.
I agree. Like, I agree with you. When I look at performance, and the both were great, I just think Ledger for that movie was just so great.
It's different. Like Ledger just totally like dominates and like absorbs and takes over the movie, whereas Jack is just like having a blast. You know, like Jack. I'm sure Heath was having fun making the movie. It does not look like it. Jack looks like he's having a lot of fun while he's in costume in 89. You know, like I can't help it. I love every minute of it.
Yep, I agree, man. It's got, I mean, obviously sentimental value for me. Just remembering like we've talked about many times, the build up for it and everything that went into that film. So that's a big part of it for me. Yes. But no, the movie itself, I'll never not want to watch that. Like, that's something if someone says, if someone says, oh, I'm going to watch 89, I'll be like, cool, let's go. I'll watch it.
Yeah,
I'll watch it with you. I'm in.
It's a nice, clean 2 hours. It's crisp. It goes by fast.
Yeah.
Even like Batman Begins, it's just like some points. In just movies in general, Dark Knight, I'm like, man, 2.5 hours. It's a long time. It's a commitment. But I feel like 2 hour mark, I'm like, boom, okay, 2 hour movie. I'm in and out. You know, I don't know what it is, but 2.5, I'm like, yeah, that's a long movie.
Well, that's why 3 hours. Movies. That's a
long movie.
Yeah. That's why most movies are 2 and under, because it's just...
You know, that's why they lost me with the Snyder Cut. They're like 4 hours. I'm like, that's a fucking...
Jesus. Movie. Yeah. Sorry. I'm good. I watched it once. I started watching it a second time, and I couldn't get
it. I did. First time I watched it, I timed it out. I watched Man of Steel, BVS, Roy, and Zack Snyder's just like back to back to back.
Jesus.
Yeah. And I had whole cream soda from the grocery store. 2 liter bottle.
Alright. Okay. So sorry about the little sidebar, but that's just
how we do it. SOG.
Right, that's how we do it.
Eric Cozy Mon holding it down.
Alright, so the end the real end, we believe, the real end of the Snyderverse films will be Aquaman in December. That's what we're told. That's what we're told to believe.
Aquaman! Oh, and we're getting...
This obviously is Aquaman 2. And of course, there was a lot of discussion that Amber Heard was going to be pulled from the movie because of her legal troubles with Johnny Depp. Obviously, she was not pulled from the film. And she recently spoke about it because she's doing a new movie, a period piece called In the Fire, which is a smaller film. And she recently spoke about it with Deadline. And she said they asked her... experience about working in a small drama versus a big budget superhero piece. And she said, these are very different kinds of projects representing two very different ends of the spectrum in my industry. There's a ton of pressure on these big franchise films with millions and millions of dollars at stake, and compromises are part of trying to make it the most successful thing it could be. Then on the other end of the spectrum is a small indie film like In the Fire, a work of art and a work of love with nowhere near the same resources. And so there are compromises there. The best luck you can have as an actor is to be able to balance both. I think that's a very mature answer to that question.
Yeah. I mean, it's just good to have balance overall in your life, right? You don't want to get sucked into like these big, giant spectacle things. And then, you know, because it takes up a lot of your time too, right? Like, you're constantly doing press. You got to go here, there, the other place. And if these smaller movies, I feel like everything's just toned down, you know?
Right. And I think, I mean, she's obviously at a point now where people are very public court case with Johnny Depp, so people know a lot more about
her. I wonder how that's going to affect this movie, because I didn't think the Ezra Miller stuff was actually going to affect it, and I think it did.
Right.
So I'm wondering, she's a little bit more of a bigger star because of Johnny Depp. I wonder what is going to happen. Like, do people not care about Aquaman enough already? Not, you know, like, is it DOA? Like, just be honest.
I mean, it's basically how much, in my opinion now, it's basically how much draw does Jason Momoa have? To get
that's a good point. Like, how big of a star is he? Can he actually pull this off?
I mean, I think that's why most people saw the first one. So
not here. If you look at it, the box office here is not very impressive. It's the over box office, especially in Asia, that really took that movie to the next level.
Right.
So you're hoping Wan strikes third act gold again.
Yes, and that's another thing. James Wan obviously is Chinese. I believe he's Chinese. That's going to make. Make China, Taiwan, same thing. He's Chinese. I mean, I know there's Mandarin and all these different kinds of Chinese, but
okay,
I don't know all of it. So yeah. So
he final E33, all complaints go there.
So yeah, so he that's probably another reason why it does well in Asia, because
he's Australian director.
So yeah. I know he is.
Okay.
But yeah, so I don't know. That movie, again, is supposed to be the end. And maybe that'll get people to see it, too. Like, oh, finally we at the end. Let's go watch
this. I don't think anybody cares. Does anybody care about this anymore? Honestly.
I mean, I want to see it because I like the first one.
I mean, I do because I really enjoyed it. But I'm just curious. Like, I just feel like, man, is the brand dead? Like, I think a lot of questions will be answered when we finally get to Aquaman's release date.
Yeah. I mean, obviously, Blue Beetle comes first. Did you see that Burger King is releasing a blue burger to go along with Blue Beetle?
It looked purple, but yes, it did.
Crazy, right?
I can't remember the last time I had Burger King, actually. So
me neither.
Maybe I'll go there. Maybe it's time I did another BOF food review.
And I reviewed the Beetle
burger.
What did you did it for the Batman pizza, right? From
Little Caesars? The what's it called? The calzone?
The calzone, yeah.
That's what it was. I did that, yeah. So yeah, maybe I'll do one for the Blue Beetle pizza. Blue Beetle burger. I'm sorry.
Yeah. That's okay.
So there you go. That's it.
Yeah. Yep. That's crazy. I'm going to try it. I'll give it a try, the burger. Definitely.
I honestly, if I go for a burger, honestly, fast food, it's usually either Sonic, Wendy's, White Castle.
Those Sonic is disgusting.
I love Sonic. Really? You're not a Sonic guy?
No.
No?
My stomach turns just hearing, saying the word. Like, I can't.
Really?
Yeah, not good.
I love Sonic. Wow. That's crazy. Yep. Well, you're a big McDonald's guy, you know, former employee and everything.
I did, yes. I did work there in high school, yes.
I heard that, I heard the secret menu is crazy. I saw someone on YouTube order a Mick 1035, and you can only get them at, like, after 10:30 in the morning. It's like some kind of breakfast. It's actually like a brunch thing, but it's like a breakfast burger combination, so.
I mean, this was a long time ago. There wasn't really a secret menu back then. With the work people who worked there, like us, we made up our stuff that we would throw together.
It's funny.
But there was nothing that the public would come in and ask for that wasn't on the menu already.
I wonder what it'd be like just ordering, making my own burger at McDonald's, just going crazy. Six patties.
Dude, I still know how to make everything. I could go back there today and go in and know how to make a Big Mac and all the burgers, all the steps.
That's impressive.
It's crazy when you think about it.
You're the patty king of the island.
Yeah, that's me.
That's it, baby. Give me that special sauce. Oh, Zimon! Whoa!
You're disgusting. Anyway.
Oh, jeez.
Yes. Oh, geez. So we've kind of been hinting at this through the whole show, but box office this summer and these movies being so bad. And Disney traditionally has been Teflon, right? Like, they've pretty much been able to release everything and everything's a hit. Or, I mean, they have bumps in the road here and there, but this year that hasn't been the case. Ant-Man and the Wasp, which we talked about, wasn't great, didn't do lots, likely to lose
basically
money.
Everything outside Spider-Verse, right?
Yeah, but I'm just talking about their films. Okay. So The Little Mermaid fell short of expectations. Elemental, not doing anything. Pixar's latest release. And, of course, Indiana Jones, close to a $3 million investment, and it's not doing well either. So we kind of been, like I said, we've been kind of beating around, talking about this, kicking it back and forth about box office this summer and what's the deal. It's kind of telling for a studio like Disney. And there's a lot of reasons we can go into that I don't even want to. There's things that we could talk about on the social side that might be impacting these films as well. But apparently Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3 looks like it's going to be the biggest earner of the year at $835 million. And this will be the first time since 2014 that Disney won't have a film that reaches the billion-dollar plateau. Again, they're not suffering or hurting. But Pete, outside, I mean, you don't go and see every Marvel film like I do. Any of these other movies, like, do you have interest in any of them?
No, I don't.
Okay.
To be brutally honest. The ones I've had interest in, I've gone and seen, you know, and, you know, if I can get to it, and a lot of it's timing too. Like, I work a lot of weekends in the winter time. So, like, if a movie comes out in the winter, it's harder for me to see it than it is in the summer.
Right.
Because I just work more weekends. But yeah, that's what it is. I don't care about these. Like, I care about the DC movies as a whole.
Right.
I really care about the Batman stuff.
Right.
I really care about Spider-Man. The MCU stuff, you know, I will see it. I'm making a point to watch it all.
Right.
But like Elemental and stuff like that, I just don't care about it. There's some previews. Like, I wanted to go see the Meg movie. Meg 2 was actually the movie like that I saw throughout the previews. I was like, I actually kind of want to see that. It's just stupid. A stupid Jason Statham movie is just fun to me. You know, like I don't even need context. I just need action. You know, like something like that is kind of, you know, Oppenheimer, because it's like, oh, it's Nolan. I should go see this.
Right.
Because I'm like, oh, I should see this. Eric's going to hate this. I should totally go see this. You know? So I'm like, it's not like that. Like, I don't know. So it's hit or miss. Like, I don't know what to tell you. Like,
I know.
Elemental just didn't do it for me.
No, I mean, I like asking those questions, people. Because I see a lot of movies. And I had no interest in Elemental. I never thought they should make The Little Mermaid. There was nothing wrong with the animated one, so why do we keep making
I like these live action Disney stuff. Like Aladdin, I really liked. I thought that was great. You know, some of them I can't remember the other ones I've seen, but Aladdin was the last one I watched. I thought it was good. Did they make a Snow White? Like, why haven't they done that?
They did make a Snow White.
They did that like weird horror version.
Yeah.
With Thor.
The Huntsman. Snow White and the Huntsman. Yeah,
with Thor.
And Kristen Stewart. Yeah, that was years ago. But yeah, they did that with her. But I mean, it's just obviously we're not back to how things were before COVID either. Russia.
I don't know.
Russian market's closed
here. Like, it feels like everything has moved on since COVID.
Yeah, but not worldwide.
Maybe. Okay.
Right. China is very picky now on what exactly they release. Russia, ever since it invaded Ukraine, Hollywood movies don't show there. Mm-hmm. Box office remains still down 20% from the pre-pandemic times. And, you know, now it's more difficult to release a film more worldwide because the international landscape isn't the same. And it's really not back yet worldwide. So, obviously, this country, we seem to rebound faster to things. And I'm not saying that we're completely rebounded. I know there's plenty of people out there who are still struggling. Based off what happened with COVID, whether it be health-wise or financially, but it's more like the worldwide interest just isn't there.
Maybe you're right about that.
So,
I don't know. I live in a little bubble of Tri-State area. Sorry.
Well, no, I mean, obviously I do too. It's just weird though. Case in point, when The Flash was coming out, we had heard so much good things about it. So I remember when I was buying my tickets, I was like, oh, I was checking to see how the theaters were.
Nobody bought tickets.
And that was the thing. Like, I was like, wow, this is strange. So that was one. And even Mission Impossible, I'm going to see it tomorrow, the new Mission Impossible. But I didn't, there was a lot of seats available there too.
Really? So, I'm interested to see if he still got it.
I know.
You know, I should go see that one.
So you should.
I should. It seems like, you know what? It seems like a good old, just a good old solid action, which is what he does. I even actually, to be honest with you, I liked his Mummy. I didn't hate it.
Well, you're alone. Odd choices.
I didn't hate it. But like, I like Tom Cruise action movies. Like, what do you want me to do? Like, I like him jumping off planes and shit.
That was a rough watch for me.
Really? I liked the Mummy stuff.
But, all right. So we're at the end of the road here for this one.
At the end of the road again.
Yep.
Here comes Holzman. Gonna take us to the end of the show.
Well, Eric, you're gonna start. So
Eric Holzman. Whoa.
Take us to the end of the show, Pete. Tell the people where they can find you.
But can I just sing to you some more?
No.
You sing to us all the time. Can I sing to you?
But I'm good. You're not. So let's go.
I have a fantastic singing voice. Holzman, he's my favorite. Holzman, catch them while you can. Holzman, he's blushing. He's so
cute. I'm not. You're just
Holzman, Holzman, come on, smile for me. Smile. Come on, there you go. That's it. That's a good boy.
I've been smiling the whole. What are you talking about?
He said you're sticking the mud.
You got issues. Pete's got issues.
Yes. I want to enjoy myself, and Eric's not letting me.
I mean, Jesus.
He's, oh, God. You can't have fun over here.
Go ahead.
Anyway, if you want to have fun with me on social media.
Yes, have fun with Pete.
You can follow me, Twitter, Instagram, Zach Snyder's favorite platform. We all know his bureau. Mastodon, Threads. Buttons, jeans, whatever kind of platform is out there at Pete Illustrated. Follow this podcast when you're listening to right now, Straight Outta Gotham, at @straight_o_GM, both Twitter and Instagram. We have a Facebook group and a Facebook fan page. I hope you've joined both. We're in both. We have a good time. Lots of good news that goes there. Everything that doesn't make the show is also there. So there's a lot more stuff for you to digest. Follow my other show, at Italians for Spidey. Follow me on batmanonfilm.com and batmanonfilm YouTube. And I make a monthly appearance with Ryan Lauer at the Batman Book Club. So that's at the Batman BC. So check that stuff out. That's a Batman podcast. So there you go. And I'm going to pass it off to my own personal Emmett Smith over here.
What?
There you go. Just hand it off. Go run. Okay. Eric.
Twitter at finally33, spell finale33. Instagram and threads, yeah. At final_e33. That's the difference there. So you can check me out there in both places. I'm trying to figure out the threads thing, seeing if it's going to be worth it or it's going to catch on.
Catch on like his OnlyFans.
Yeah. Oh, no. My OnlyFans did not catch on, sadly. But yeah, guys, interact with us there, of course. Pete gave the show handle on Twitter as well. We mostly news, but if you guys want to talk to us there, check us out at @straight_o_G, of course. The Facebook stuff, definitely. The group's been a lot more active lately. I want to thank you guys for that. We've had a lot of fun discussing certain things. I don't know why Pete put his doomsday poll under his account and not and not the show account, but it's okay.
I'm watching it. Let's do this.
But yeah, check us out. Check us out all over our socials, obviously. Again, if you're fans of the New York Knicks, I do a show called All Nicked Up at @all_nicked_up on Twitter. We do a show every Wednesday night at 8:30 p.m. Discussing the New York Knicks. And right now, they're kind of slow off season that they've had. But if you're fans of the Knicks, again, check us out over there every Wednesday night and on YouTube and on Facebook Live. That's where we're at. So I think that's it.
I think you nailed it. All nicked up. What you gonna do? Halsey Mon and his basketball crew. Woo!
Halsey Mon! I think I'm going to edit that out before we end the show.
Booyah!
All right, let's shut this one down. So for Pete, I'm Eric. You're listening to Straight Outta Gotham, and we'll see you next time.
Booyah!